Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Vodcast that's going to introduce acids and bases, more so acids than bases. This first video is going to be definitely at the academic level, even honors level, even entry or first or general science college students. This video will work for you, but this video is really just about what's an acid, why is an acid, and how to identify it according to Arrhenius, and then maybe even Bronsted-Lowry. So let's get into it without further delay. So again, this is piggybacking right up off of my class. We've just kind of discussed ionic bonds. We've just kind of discussed dissociation. So again, the first thing I'm going to talk about is kind of trying to relate that and then look at it as far as what Arrhenius said way back in the day. So here we go. Again, if you remember, to dissociate means simply to separate or to break apart. I always tell my students, think of it as like a divorce, to separate. And a more specific way of saying it is to dissociate or to separate into its constituent ions, into its separate individual ions. So if we take the world's most popular salt, NaCl, sodium chloride, NaCl, when you throw it in water, it's going to separate. The cation and anion will separate. You'll get your cation, which is the sodium ion with the 1+, and you'll get your chloride, which is the 1-. Again, during the ionic chapter, we discussed how we go from this nice, very stable crystalline ionic structure, and how, again, big thing here to talk about when you talk about dissociation is how water, that polar bent molecule that is water, that beautiful, amazing compound that gives us life as we know it, the negatives will surround the cations from our ionic crystalline structure, and the positive ends, the hydrogen ends of water, will surround the anion parts, which, again, is bigger, and you can see our sodium and chloride from here. We looked at how we express that, how we can write it in not so much the picture form. And remember, the water is always there, but to clean it up, we could drop the water and, again, just think of the different ions. And yes, there should be aqueous around here, but again, remember, this is more of an entry-level PowerPoint. Again, if we were to look at something like magnesium chloride, it too is an ionic compound, metal with a non-metal, it too is going to dissociate. The only trick here was that the subscript of 2 for the chlorine tells me that for every 1 mole of magnesium chloride, I'm going to get 1 mole of magnesium ions and 2 moles of chlorine ions, or chloride, as now it's in its ionic form. Okay, so very similar to how our other ionic compounds dissociate, we would again split down the middle here where the cation ends. And again, now that I have my pen active, so why not put the AQ in there? And we're also going to get that anion, and again, we're going to put the AQ in there. And if we're going to put water in the reactants, why not keep it in the products, and it's going to stay in its liquid form? We could just clean that up very simply, again, without the water, by just adding our hydronium ion, our H+, which we know is going to be 1+, it's because it's in group 1, our chloride ion, which we know is going to be -1 because it's in group 7. So at this point, you might be saying, okay, so what's the big deal? Why are acids anything different? Why do we have a whole new branch of science for this, and why the hell do we even have this video? Well, the reason why is because unlike the cations of a normal ionic compound, this H+ ion does a very, very interesting thing, and really, this H+ really is just a proton. Hydrogen is really just one proton, one electron. We've ripped the electron off it. It's now just a proton, and here's what's really, really nuts about this. Rather than just being hidden in between the pockets of water, this H+ actually looks at water. It looks at that fact that water, in that beautiful bent molecule that is water, it has those two lone pairs just sitting on top that are just waiting there. And if you remember, lone pairs are very, very negative. They're, two lone pairs of electrons, very negative. So this positive, this free-floating proton, this H+, gets very, very excited by water, sees those lone pairs, and actually attaches itself. And so it actually creates a new compound. This is something completely different. Water is no longer water. It's now H3O+, or as we know it, hydronium. But later, as far as how it does also change the geometry of water. So we're going to kind of rip through, a few slides here. Usually I play a little word game here. When you think of the word acids, maybe you think of, danger. If you're one of those bio nerds out there and you enjoy amino acids, yeah, you're welcome, biology. Without chemistry, there's no biology. But you could think amino acids if you're like me, and sometimes you are lucky enough to have some acid indigestion. Maybe you've heard of, acid that way. Or maybe if you're one of those acid rain people. But don't forget and don't sleep on the fact that acids are essential to our life. things like vitamin C, ascorbic acid, which we find in oranges and other citrus fruits, lemons, vinegar, acetic acid, et cetera, et cetera. Here are just some other products in our daily lives that maybe you come in contact with that could be considered acidic. Marca sauce, a.k.a. tomato ketchup, which Heinz 57, let's go Pittsburgh, is like the best flavor there is, or the best kind there is, if you ask me. Again, our different vinegars, there's our vitamin C. Coca-Cola or sodas, really, in general, believe it or not, if you were to put a baby tooth into a cup of soda, it would dissolve after a couple days. If you have some skin, some acne problems, you may have heard of folic acid before. Aspirin, even toilet cleaners. Remember, for every yin, there has to be a yang. So for acids, the flip side to acids are bases. Bases can be just as dangerous as acids. Hopefully you know a little bit about bleach. You know, you don't want to come in contact with it. You don't want to drink it. You don't really want to inhale it. But other things like Mylanta, if you're having stomach problems, well, your stomach acid indigestion problems, well, you throw a base in there to neutralize it. And baking soda, I've got baking soda. A little pH scale, again, should be familiar with the pH scale, 7 being neutral, above 7 is basic, below 7 is acidic. These are just some pictures I've borrowed off of Google Images, and again, I think it's very funny that most people, when they create these pictures, they have the pH at 7, and then actually as it goes down, the pH actually goes up, and that's where, again, we're basic, and then actually as it goes up, the pH actually goes down. Okay, so some common properties and characteristics. You really should know this about acids and bases, but again, if this is your first time learning, some general things that just really any chemistry student that's ever taken chemistry should know. Acids taste sour or tart. Again, think of like your oranges, think of your lemons, those types of things. Whereas I always say, bases be bitter, yo. Bases be bitter. A lot of students sometimes screw up the difference between sour and tart versus bitter. Sour tart, think Sour Patch Kids, think Warheads if you're into candy. Bitter, not that anybody's accidentally ever gotten soap in your mouth or that, you know, maybe a guardian of yours has ever put it in there. But if you've ever gotten soap by accident in your mouth, that's what it means to be bitter. Very importantly, acids react with metals to produce gases, usually those hydrogen bubbles. The hydrogen off of the acid pops off, and there we get our pure hydrogen gas, whereas bases do not. There's a very big chemical difference between the two. Scary thing about acids is that if you were to touch it, it would actually feel like water until it starts to burn your skin. But bases feel very slippery, and again, if you think about bases mainly as soaps, that it kind of makes sense that maybe they're bitter and that they would feel slippery. If you were to use universal indicator paper, acids turn the indicator paper red. So if you wanted to test for an acid, you'd use blue indicator paper and hope that it would turn red. Where bases, not only do they be bitter, but bases be blue. Bases, again, on universal indicator paper will turn it blue. If you don't have universal indicator paper, grab some red indicator paper, and if it turns blue, you know that the solution has become basic. Okay, so here is the big deal. Again, Svante Arrhenius was one of the first people to kind of crack this nut and to start to really realize that although these are ionic compounds, something like HNO3, when it dissociates and gives us H+ and NO3-, this being nitric acid, and this is the H+ ion and the nitrate ion, what he realized was, again, that this H+ was going to go and attack water and change it. So although this is ionic or ionically bonded as per electronegativities, we have something else going on here. So what Svante Arrhenius said in the first definition, and this is still a pretty good definition, even as we'll learn about Bronsted-Lowry, acids are anything that begin with an H, because the H+ is going to be the cation. You always start with the cation, and therefore H+ is going to be donated first. And anything that dissociates and gives us H+ will increase that H+ and attack water accordingly. Okay, so here's the money slide. So again, why did Arrhenius say that anything begins with an H is an acid? Well, when this HCl, hydrochloric acid, which you're probably pretty familiar with, when this dissociates, this chlorine, this Cl- is going to separate, and this H+ is going to separate. But again, watch, this H+ is not just going to stay dormant, this H+ is going to attack the water, and so I go from this bent polar molecule that is water with my two lone pairs up top to having one of those lone pairs now become a bonding pair. I still have one lone pair up top, so I actually now go from a bent shape to a trigonal pure middle, still polar, but again, drastically different in the actual geometry, and then therefore differently in its chemical properties. Upon further research, Svante Arrhenius realized, okay, well, the yang to the yin that are acids must be these things called bases. And at the time, the technology and the different experimentation that Svante did, he could only find that the only thing that would actually attract those H pluses, and the only thing that could actually counteract and therefore protect water, in a sense, if you think about it, from those acids, was something that would actually release hydroxide ions, or OH1-. That's the formula for hydroxide. So what he realized was anything that ended in OH or hydroxide, therefore, must be a base, because when it dissociates, it's going to give us that hydroxide, and those OH- ions are actually going to be more attractive for any free-flowing H+ ions than water would be. And so therefore, it's actually stronger than water, it would negate or neutralize an acid, and therefore the base is born. According to Arrhenius, if you don't start with an H, if you don't end in an OH, if you do not release hydrogens, or you do not release hydroxides, well then, as I always say, you're just a stupid stinking salt. So again, going back to what we know as salt, which is really table salt, really any metal with a non-metal is a salt. This is not going to give me an H+, it's not giving me an OH-, therefore it must be a salt. So really the first place to kind of take a break here, and this is kind of the end of the first podcast, is to understand, and you got to be able to identify, well, am I working with an acid, am I working with a base, or am I working with a salt? Because acids affect the pH of water very differently, bases affect it the opposite, and salts really don't affect it at all. So again, recapping the notes that we've taken so far, anything that begins with an H, such as nitric acid, is an acid because it starts with an H, and therefore it's going to donate that hydrogen ion. Anything that ends in an OH is a base because it's going to donate that hydroxide ion. And again, if you do not start with an H, you do not end in an OH, you're not going to donate an H+, you're not going to give an OH-, and so therefore you'd be classified as a salt. Here are just some real quick practice problems for you to take a look at. Again, look at what it starts with, look what the compound starts with, look what the compound ends with. Again, if it starts with an H, it's an acid. If it ends in an OH, it's a base. If it has neither, well, then it must be a salt. So I would advise you to pause at this moment, test yourself, and then see how you do. And again, you can now see our answers over here. H2SO4 is actually sulfuric acid. It begins with an H, so it's an acid. HCl, hydrochloric acid, again, begins with an H, so it must be an acid. NH4OH, this is ammonium hydroxide. This is actually a very interesting compound. We'll talk about this more in future vodcasts. Ends in an OH, so therefore it must be a base. Potassium nitrate, KNO3, doesn't begin with an H, doesn't end in an OH, therefore it's just a stupid stinking salt. And KOH, again, ends potassium hydroxide, ends in hydroxide, so it's a base. This is actually acetic acid. This is an organic compound. It's written this way for a reason. Notice how the H is pulled out. That's so that you, or I, or anybody really, could actually see that this is obviously an acid because it starts with an A. Hope you've enjoyed this vodcast. Hope that this has helped you gain a small insight as to why acids are different than normal ionic compounds, and also help you identify Arrhenius acids, bases, and or salts. If you're looking for more practice, feel free to visit mahanchem.com. In the search bar, just look for Arrhenius acids, and I have a worksheet up there for the whatever day I assigned it. Thanks for tuning in. Check you on the next one.